She's just amazing.
Welcome to The Great Reboot. I'm Tori Ryden, a company that started out of the creation of a lightweight wallet made from sailcloth has shifted direction and is now in pandemic mode, creating PPEs, personal protection equipment, to help healthcare workers on the front lines of the pandemic. The company is Flowfold, and the company's chief operating officer, James Morin, joins us now. And welcome to The Great Reboot. I do hope you're doing well, James.
Thank you. I wish I was in studio with you, but this is okay for right now. So.
Well, this is the best we can do for right now. When things shift and change, we can do it in person, maybe right there in Gorham. I know you guys have a big factory there. I've visited you there before. It's a great operation. Obviously, that's probably a little bit different now. Kind of take us inside, because are people still working inside? And tell me how people have kind of shifted around because of COVID-19.
Yeah, you know, in many ways, I don't even know what it looks like anymore. I'm not allowed in to our Gorham headquarters. We're treating that thing like the Pentagon. And it's because right now, the most important thing to our success as a company and as individuals is that we stay healthy. So no one goes in or out of the facility unless they're a Flowfold employee. And we've even taken some extreme measures, like we've ordered pods to be out back of our facility that are staging areas for incoming and outgoing packages, so we have a chance to stabilize them or to sterilize them. So we aren't really taking any chances. I mean, we're following this very carefully, and we're in this for the long haul.
You have such an interesting story. So for people who are not familiar with Flowfold, you've been making outdoor gear that's made of recycled sailcloth. People may have seen the popular wallets at pretty large outdoor gear stores. Special bean boots, LL Bean boots. I think it was the first time that LL Bean had ever actually used another company to help them manufacture. Tell me a little bit about that. And really, you know, it all started again from that recycled wallet.
Yeah. So the company, we're celebrating our 10-year anniversary in May, and I don't know what that's going to look like. And none of us had ever thought that in year 10, we'd be selling $1 million worth of face shields. But here we are. And so, you know, the history of the company is very simple. It's your quintessential broken Stoke story. Devin and Charlie Charlie was working in a sail loft. He took recycled sailcloth out of the trash and sewed himself a wallet. Met Devin and I in college, and the business was started in 2010. And, you know, I joke, but Forbes wrote an article that said we're not selling wallets for beer money anymore. But in the beginning, the first 5 years, it was very much just a hobby, you know. And we set up a table downtown and in Portland, Maine, and sold wallets to people coming off cruise ships, and went to fairs and local markets and started to sell online. And slowly but surely, that business matured. We raised money in 2016, and that enabled us to become more of a successful commercial business that we are today, selling into companies like L.L. Bean and Urban Outfitters, REI, expanding internationally into mostly Japan, but also South Korea. So that was sort of what the business looked like under normal times. And we were a very healthy business. We were growing. Certain channels were growing 30 to 50% a year over year. And we were really just starting to get kind of some interesting collaborations. Like you mentioned the bean boot, but we had some other things in the works. And a lot of that right now is on hold, understandably. But we're fully expecting that when we do turn the corner, whenever that is, that we'll be back to being our normal, healthy, outdoor, everyday travel accessory company. And quite frankly, we're looking forward to that.
Yeah, I bet. And it's going to happen. It's just, it's a game of patience. And in the meantime, you're not letting any of your machines sit idle or your employees. Tell me a little bit, James, about that aha moment about, wait a second, we can do something here. And just take us through that, because that's, you know, not everybody kind of shifted that way.
Yeah. You know, last time, ironically, I was just thinking, last time you and I talked, we talked a lot about self-awareness, right? And I think that having that self-awareness is just as important for a business, to be aware of what you excel at as a business. And if you look at Flowfold, it was very obvious. I mean, in March 11th, I flew to Wisconsin, just to give you an idea of how fast this happened. In March 11th, I flew to Wisconsin to meet with Duluth. And they're another big partner of ours. And we were talking about fall 2020. And that was March 11th when flying was still okay. And you could still get into a meeting with more than 10 people and have this conversation. But even shortly after that, travel became completely unacceptable. And then we started to see more stories pop up about, specifically in hot zones, Seattle, New York, areas that where PPE was becoming, hospital PPE, personal protective equipment, was becoming more and more scarce. So that kind of, it was first that we started to see the articles, and then we started to look at our own budgets, and we started to forecast, and we started to say, you know, this isn't going to go away. This will be a problem. And then retail stores started locking their doors. POs started to get canceled or put on hold. And you realize really quickly that this is going to be a problem. We were going to have capacity. We didn't know how much capacity. We didn't know if it was going to be 50% Flowfold, 50% hospital PPE, or 75, 25, 25, 75. We had no clue, but we knew we'd have some sort of capacity to help out. As soon as we identified that, we reached out to Maine Medical, or Maine Med, but Maine Health Partners, and we said, all right, we're going to have capacity. We don't know how much. What do you need? What do you need the most of? They sent us a URL that's a catalog with everything that they needed, and it was everything. It was everything. It was booties. It was face shields. It was face masks. It was aprons. Everything that they used, they were on short supply of. And so when I'm going to circle back to this idea of being business aware. We looked at the catalog. We looked at the team that we had, the expertise that we had, the equipment that we had, and we said, what could we do really well on this catalog? And it was the face shield. And then we said, we're going to make a prototype. We're going to get it to their infectious disease department to review. And then we're going to get going and we're going to see how many we can make. And it started at 250 per day. And now it's closer to 5,000. But it took a couple of weeks to get there and to scale up. But that's how it happened. That's how it all unfolded.
Well, for people who are watching who are not from Maine, Maine Medical Center is the biggest hospital in the state of Maine. And, really, there are so many great surgeons and doctors and nurses who are in there who I'm sure appreciate it. But 5,000 a day, does that mean that you're now sending face shields to other hospitals outside of Maine as well?
Yes, we've sent face shields all over the country at this point, Texas, California, Illinois, Chicago, Colorado, and then all along the Northeast. We basically sent face shields to pretty much all of the major hospitals in Maine and some in Boston and New Hampshire and Vermont as well.
Wow. Talk about, I mean, you know, when you looked at that catalog and you could have chosen anything to create, and you created maybe the most important piece of this puzzle in keeping people protected.
Well, I mean, sometimes you just kind of get lucky and it's weird to say it's lucky right now, but I mean, in the sense that we knew we weren't going to be good at any of the wearables. We don't make apparel, right? And so the face shield made perfect sense. And I do have an example I'll show you.
Oh, great.
The face shield, it just has a very, very thin layer of PEP, plastic material that's see-through, right? No problem seeing through that. And then some stitching on the outside to hold the elastic band and then the comfortable piece, the foam, on the forehead. But the key there for us was to be able to cut out thousands and thousands of the thin plastic sheet per day with our computerized cutting machine. So it's kind of coincidental. Earlier this year, or earlier in 2019, we purchased, with the help of Maine Technology Institute, a computerized cutting table that's 24 feet long. And with the help of that grant, we invested almost $250,000 into building out what we're calling sort of our high-tech kind of computerized manufacturing facility in Maine. That enabled us to do this at a very rapid pace. So at this point, we're using that cutting table about 16 hours per day, and we're going to have to scale up and potentially find an additional source to cut the material, because that's how much the demand has picked up since we first started.
That's incredible. The shield itself, does that have any of the sailcloth in it?
Well, yeah. So, I mean, so the PET film is basically, we worked with the sale loft to help us get that film, but it's effectively the same technology that is designed to be used on high intensity and sailing and windsurfing and kitesurfing. So the material is extremely lightweight, extremely durable. We're working right now, we're workshopping with the sail mill to figure out how resistant it is to chemicals from a, you know, we're not advising on if these can be reused or cleaned or not, but we're going to figure out, can you sterilize them and then reuse them? So we're working on that right now as we speak. But yeah, it's a very high tech material. We're getting it in the, you know, hundreds and hundreds of yards of rolls and then using our fancy equipment to cut it into face shields.
That's amazing. As far as your workforce goes, have you been able to keep all of your employees on? Have you ramped up? I mean, what is that, your kind of quote, small business story, because you're a larger business now, but, you know, just curious, you've been able to remain afloat.
Yeah. So we are a relatively small business, although we're doing, you know, millions in revenue, you know, for the most part, we're eight people in our, in 3,500 square feet in Gorham, Maine. We have contract manufacturers that we work with for some of the larger POs for our larger accounts and also our international business. But yeah, we were able to keep everyone employed. We've actually since scaled up and we're in the process of doing that right now. We've actually brought in temporary construction offices and we put them in our parking lot in Gorham, Maine. And that's where we're going to have additional workforce come in and help us assemble these shields. So we do plan to ramp up. We do plan to continue to work with the other contract manufacturers like American Roots, as an example, to help us assemble these as well. So basically what we have decided to do as a company is everything in our power to A, make sure that our team is fully employed, paying mortgages, continuing to pay healthcare for our team, which is very important to us, but also make sure that we do our part, both morally and ethically, to create as many of these shields as we can, as long as there is a demand. And I have gone on record several times saying, I hope that we aren't making shields in 2 weeks. I don't think that's going to be the case, but I hope that we aren't. I hope that either we're sort of back to normal and we're turning the corner, or that other people can make them for cheaper than us and get them to the hospitals, because they are spending a lot more money for ours than they normally used to, because they're normally made overseas.
Right, exactly. And, you know, you will probably, I would think, come out of this even a stronger company with a stronger sense of self.
I think that, you know, you talk about branding. There's just a lot about this that is on brand for Flowfold, right? Taking something that I think is relatively mundane and a face shield. And arguably, I guess I'm a bit biased, but I honestly think from what I've seen out there that we probably have one of the best face shields on the market right now. And I mean that because we make our products to be able to be used every single day. And this isn't a throwaway item for us. Like, this is an item that a doctor who has to work a 12-hour shift, back-to-back shifts, is going to feel very comfortable wearing. And I think that's something that we take pride in. As far as how we'll recover, I mean, I think that's going to be a little bit dependent on the public. And what I've been encouraging everybody, every single chance I have, is not just Flowfold, but to really remember all the small businesses out there that have been impacted, because we are going to turn the corner. I don't think we're going to turn the corner all of a sudden. I don't think we're going to be flooding 50,000 people into stadiums for concerts or sporting events, but we will recover. Main Street will eventually be active. I think bars and restaurants will have fewer tables and fewer chairs, but we're going to be able to go back out there. We're going to be able to go get haircuts again, because I haven't been able to get a haircut for 3 weeks. And I hope that we remember the small businesses that weren't able to pivot like Flowfold was able to pivot. And we take some of that government stimulus money and we put it back into the economy, because there's a lot of people that are going to need that help.
You had mentioned a collaboration with the company American Roots, which is a really great company in Maine as well. They make a lot of, they make blankets and they make a lot of different clothing items. And I'm curious, what are they doing for you? They also employ, you know, part of their mantra is that they put a lot of immigrants to work. And they go through a seamstress training program and all of that. So it's a real rigorous program over there. So is this the first collaboration you've done with American Roots or other companies? And has this inspired additional collaborations? Because I keep seeing, I mean, I think that's the marvelous thing that comes out of this is kind of that, all right, we are totally in this together.
Yeah, I mean, look, Ben and Whitney Waxman are personal friends of mine, right? But there, it's way more than that. And I've been saying since the beginning that, you know, Flowfold is a domestic brand, 100% made in America, same as American Roots. The advantage of being made in America right now is not some sort of rah-rah patriotism. I mean, the U.S., if you look at consumers, they're willing to spend about 10% more for American-made products. And we can't make, American Roots or Flowfold can't make, whether it's a fleece or a wallet, we can't make it for 10% more than something international. So there's not, that's not the benefit. The benefit of being made in America right now is speed and agility. It gives us the opportunity. We already had sort of the domestic partners for sourcing raw materials, as did American Roots. We had the contacts with connections and people to be able to help us scale up efficiently. If we were overseas, we simply couldn't do that. And so I originally went to Maine Med, walked in. We were 6 feet apart from each other very early on, and we had a box in the center of the room with all of the PPE that Maine Health decided that they needed, face shield included. And I took that and I looked at it and I immediately knew the aprons, the booties, the masks, all of those things. The first person that came to mind was Ben Waxman at American Roots. I knew that they had the team talking about being aware of what you are good at. I knew that they were going to be able to effectively do this. And I also knew that he was probably struggling as well. And so it was a very easy decision to join forces with him. I respect the way in which he does business, and I think that's important. And I think it's a great example of people coming together, rallying behind something that's bigger than themselves, and really being able to capitalize on being a small, agile, you know, small business like both American Roots and Flowfold are.
Give me a quick forecast, if you would. Do you think, you know, when we're back to normal, do you think people will remember the work of these small American businesses that actually came to the front and said, and to the fore and said, look, we are going to shift, we're going to change, and we're doing this because we care about protecting Americans and others. Do you think you're going to get that support? Do you think people's memories will be that long?
I don't know. The other podcast you have is Positively Maine, right? Or so, you know, so like I think if I was to put my optimistic hat on, I would say yes to a certain extent. I don't know. And you know, sometimes the government has to step up and actually force it. Sometimes, and that if you're asking me to kind of forecast out a little bit, there may be a scenario where the government says, you know, we made a mistake here. Not only is all the hospital PPE made overseas, the raw materials to make the personal protective equipment is overseas. We have completely made ourselves dependent on overseas marketing or manufacturing to keep our healthcare workers safe. Now, whether or not the individual remembers that or not, the government has to remember that, I think. And you may see a scenario where a certain percentage of the national stockpile is made from U.S. manufacturing facilities. And that may mean that some companies, maybe not Flowfold, maybe not American Roots, but some of the people that have pivoted will continue to have to make hospital, you know, PPE in the future. I don't know if that's going to happen for us individually, but that's an interesting thing to think through. As far as the memory for supporting small business, I hope so. But it's also, look, hope isn't a strategy. I think that Flowfold right now, very soon, once we start to kind of scale up, we're going to have to start creating some content. We're going to have to start reminding people what we did and letting them know why we weren't able to ship them their wallet, you know, for 2 weeks because we were helping to put, you know, make our healthcare workers safer. So it's a little bit on us. And I hope that I just keep on encouraging people to remember the small businesses because there's a lot that are going to be struggling right now.
Speaking of content, this is video content and marketing. You are a master of that. And I'd love for you to give your website and then, you know, steer people. I mean, you have really produced some beautiful videos from your travels overseas and around the country. So go ahead and give a pitch for that if you would.
Sure. So our website is flowfold.com. Very simple. And if you want to learn more specifically about what we're doing in the fight against COVID-19 and the pandemic, you can go to flowfold.com/PPE, personal protective equipment. And that'll kind of give you an idea of what we're going through and why we made that transition. You know, right now we aren't back to normal. I would say we're probably 95% of our effort, our focus, our time, our materials and resources is spent on protecting those on the front line, whether it's doctors, nurses, firefighters, or policemen. But there will be a time when we turn the corner. And I think the other thing to be very careful of and very aware of is that about 30 to 40% of many small businesses in retail, their revenue comes from the holidays, Q4. And there, we may see a spike of this pandemic. We may have a yo-yo effect of this pandemic here next fall. And if that happens, remember to continue to support small local businesses, Floatfold included, when you're thinking about gifts, because it's going to be a very challenging year, I think, for all small businesses, Floatfold included. So any help you can, gift cards, gift buying, we're still shipping online, we're still allowing gift cards, so anything goes a long way.
That's a great idea. I mean, you know, keep it local and support, you know, all of our we've got people in our families who are working in small business. So keep that going. Have you been surprised, James, at the creativity that you're seeing just among, you know, regular people who may not have shown such creativity in the past in their home, and they're kind of thinking outside the box and everybody wants to help. Have you been surprised by that?
Well, I mean, I think that this is, this is what's impressive about the resilience of a human being, right? I mean, historically, whether it's been COVID or 9/11 or Pearl Harbor or others, we rally behind something that's bigger than ourselves. And when you know, there are things outside of our control, we pick ourselves up by our bootstraps and we figure out, you know, how to move forward. And I think that this is a perfect example of that. And I think this is why, in many ways, America is one of the greatest countries in the world to live in. Doesn't come without challenges. And I think that I think that the president yesterday in his remarks talked about mental health and how they're really starting to take that seriously. If we're cooped up in our houses for the next 3 to 4 months, that and that could be best case scenario, that's going to create some challenges for all of us. And so figuring out a way to kind of harness that energy that we have, that we can't get out of our systems by going out and hanging out with friends or going to bars or going to beaches or Walt Disney, like, we're going to have to figure out ways to get that creativity out. And we will figure that out. And I think some of those things, believe it or not, will stick. And I think we're going to start to see some changes. I think more people are going to be able to work from home. I think that we're going to start to see some permanent changes from that, from new creative behavior. And that is a silver lining, if you will.
You mentioned mental health, and I want to give a quick shout out, a quick plug to one of our other shows that we, actually produced, and it was with NAMI Maine, which is the National Alliance of Mental Illness. And Jenna Maynard was on, she's the CEO. And so if people are struggling with mental health issues right now, I just want to say, please go check that out. We've got some really important phone numbers and website information. So anyway, it's always good to kind of cross-pollinate, right, when we have the opportunity. James, I'm just so happy that you had that aha moment and that you're helping so many people. It must just internally feel so rewarding. Maybe you haven't had a chance to catch your breath to really think about the depth of your, you know, your kind of light bulb going off and what that's doing for so many healthcare workers who, gosh, your heart has got to hurt every morning. You think about these people who are just giving, they are our true heroes and, our saviors.
Yeah, we haven't had time to take a victory lap. I simply don't think that we will either, because again, I can't emphasize enough that we were able to make this pivot, and this helped us keep our lights on and helped keep our team employed. It's not like this is altruistic. We aren't a big organization. We aren't Tesla, Google, Amazon. We're able to donate millions of space shields. I wish we could. And honestly, the hardest thing in my career. The hardest thing in my career so far has been to go to these hospitals and ask them to spend 5, 6, 7 times more than what they're used to spending on these things. Because of the idea of price gouging is something that I take very, very seriously. The fact of the matter is we're basically trying to cover our overhead. We're trying to break even, but it has been challenging. It has been challenging, and it's been heartbreaking to have people call my cell and say, I'm willing to give you my own personal credit card. Can you just send me 15 shields, 20 shields? It's been hard, but we continue to be reminded every single day by the bravery that's happening on the front lines, and that's keeping us going. And honestly, I just, for me personally, one victory lap I will take is just in response to my team. Never once have Floatfold employees second-guessed our process. Never once have they wanted to just stay home and spend time with, you know, their families, and they have the complete right to do so. They have stepped up to this challenge. They have rallied behind this, and they have made a pivot like I've never seen before. Eight days we went from meeting Maine Health that first time, 8 days from that first meeting to being able to ship 1,000 shields to Maine Health. That is remarkable to me, and it couldn't have happened if the team didn't 100% buy in. They did buy in. I have the best team in the face of the earth. I will look, and I'll die on that hill. And so very grateful, very, very grateful for them.
Wow, well, that's astounding. Well, from all of the earthbound saviors, talking about healthcare workers and those who work in the hospitals, those who are on the front lines and stores, helping all of us to kind of keep at least a little bit of a normal, keeping our shelves stocked and all that. I just want to thank you, James Morin from Flowfold. You guys are doing a great job and helping so many people. And I just wish all of you the best of luck. I'm really extremely happy for you. Just keep up the great work.
I appreciate it. Thank you for letting me tell the story.